Good morning, First Church family and friends. It is so good to be with you. My name's David. Welcome to First Church of Christ Online. I hope you enjoyed that extra hour of sleep that you got this morning and that you feel refreshed and ready to worship. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. We're so thankful to be able to worship together like this, and we praise God that you've chosen to be here. If it's your first time with us, First Church of Christ is simply people becoming the church, and so connection's really important. Would you go ahead and fill out a digital connect card either by clicking on the tab located at the top of the church online platform or by clicking the appropriate link located in the description of this video if you're watching on YouTube. Also, feel free to interact during this gathering in the online chat. You can leave a comment, share a prayer request. You can even invite your friends to watch this service along with you this morning. In a moment, we're going to jump into some songs of worship. And then after that, you'll be invited to participate in a time of communion. And so go ahead right now and gather your elements, some bread and some juice, so you'll be ready when that time comes. And then after that, I'm going to be sharing the next message in our series, The Hope of Heaven, with a message entitled, Heaven, What Will It Be Like? I know that God's going to speak a message of peace and comfort to you today. All righty, let's go ahead and jump into a time of praise and worship.
We worship the God who evermore will be. keep that going. We're going to keep that joy going. We serve a faithful, wonderful God. He's worthy of all our praise. So we're just going to keep singing to him today.
To storm brigades in my heart. The veil in between was torn apart. Now you hold the keys to the grave. Cause you bring things alive. You roll storms away.
Ellie sat in the third row, left-hand side of the worship center. Ellie was from the wrong side of the tracks. Her clothes weren't the best and sometimes not the cleanest. She didn't always clean up well, especially at first, but she was there every Sunday. Ellie didn't always eat well, and many of her meals in years past had been served from the dumpster side of restaurants. And even now, she had few dishes and little money for food. Actually, she wasn't that good of a cook. The Binghams, on the other hand, sat in that same row. They might have been the wealthiest family in the congregation, though there was nothing ostentatious about them. Their home was in a better part of town. Their clothes were always clean and neat, and they smelled good. The Binghams' dishes always matched. Their dining room table was the picture, you know, better homes and garden looking like table. The food was plentiful and the aroma made your mouth water. Meals were a family event in the Bigham household. John and Mary had been attending church since they were little, and now they were bringing up their children in the same church. Ellie, on the other hand, began coming to church as much out of desperation as anything. But she came. Every Sunday, Ellie and the Binghams shared that third row pew, left-hand side. It might have been the most incongruous arrangement in the entire building. Bingham's, wealthy, well-dressed, polished. Ellie, her ragged clothes, a parable of her rugged life. And as different as they could be, sharing the same pew. But that's not all they shared. As different as their lives outside the confines of the church building might be, they were identical once they entered. For every Sunday, they shared a meal in common, the one that we call the Lord's Supper. At this table, one's address doesn't matter. At this table, one's clothes are insignificant. At this table, one's past is forgotten and one's present is inconsequential. Here, it's His presence that matters. Here, it's His blood-spattered garments that hold our attention. Here, everyone is equal. At this table, Galatians chapter 3, verse 28 reminds us, there is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Have you ever noticed that life is always better when a vacation is on the horizon? I mean, it's just a fact of life. When you're going on a long trip, you may contact a travel agency or you surf the internet or talk to friends who've had a great experience somewhere. And so you begin to look at pictures and, you know, with the rising gas prices these days, you begin to calculate whether you want to fly or you want to drive. You do searches for activities and events while you're there and maybe along the way. You check out your frequent flyer accounts or your hotel reward programs to see if you can maybe cash in on a free ticket or some reduced priced lodging. You check out the golf courses and the shopping malls on the internet. And as the day approaches, your excitement and your anticipation just swells. When you're a week out, you begin to check out the 10-day forecast and you start checking it daily until that moment that you depart. Well, the Bible tells us that each one of us is going on a long trip. In fact, it's going to last for eternity. And you'll be assigned to one of two different places, either heaven or hell. There is no middle ground. But for such an important journey, we should put more time and energy into planning for that than we do any earthly travel. Choice, not chance, will determine your eternal destination. Now, for some reason, we pastors have failed to preach about the glories of heaven. You know, back in the 50s and the 60s, there were frequent sermons delivered to kind of frighten people into the faith by touting the horrors of hell. You know, those hellfire brimstone sermons. But in the past 50 years or so, while most pulpits shy away from speaking about the reality of hell, another mistake that we've made is to not stress the glories of heaven. There are a lot of Christian people who aren't excited about heaven for the very same reason they're scared of their computer or their digital camera. They just don't know enough about it, and their ignorance breeds fear. And there are so many erroneous thoughts that circulate and are attached to Christians. Another factor is that Satan is a liar, and he knows that he is doomed for all of eternity. And since he was kicked out of heaven and into hell, he doesn't want you to have any inkling of what heaven is really like. That's why Revelation chapter 13, verse 6 tells us that Satan's favorite lies are about heaven. Speaking of the satanic beast, John writes in Revelation chapter 13, verse 6, "He opened his mouth to blaspheme God and to slander his name and his dwelling place and those who live in heaven." Author and preacher Randy Alcorn points out, our enemy slanders three things: God's person, God's people, and God's place, heaven. Well, today you're going to hear me quote Randy Alcorn several times. This author has written several books on the topic of heaven, and he really stretches your thinking. He challenges some of the myths that we have of heaven that are based on our own preconceived notions versus what the Bible says. And to me, it just makes sense to look for our answers in the Bible. You know, the divinely inspired verses by the creator of the universe, the one who went to such incredible lengths to purchase your admission ticket into heaven at the cost of his one and only son. Don't you think it would be better if you were more excited about heaven than you were frightened about hell? But today I want you to learn about this place that God has prepared for you. And I believe that if you learn what it's like, then you will long to be there. And so to begin with, heaven is an actual place. You know, we often have this picture of clouds and of a fog or a mist, and we envision St. Peter at the pearly gates and everyone wearing white robes. In our minds, we picture heaven, a heaven that isn't the biblical picture of heaven. Heaven is not just some figment of our imagination. Heaven is not a state of the mind. Heaven is a literal place. The Bible says so. Last week, we talked about Jesus' words in John 14, 2, where he says to his disciples, "I am going there to prepare a place for you." Heaven will feel like home. Now, I love living in Cherokee here, but when I drive to my hometown of Kansas City, Kansas, when I'm about 5 miles from where I grew up, going on along on I-435, I come around a curve, and right before me, I see this all-encompassing view of the Missouri River and the bridge that will take us across that river to the Kansas side. And I might say to my family, "I'm home. I'm home. We're back in the promised land." And my loving, though sometimes insistent, family sometimes laughs in my face about that statement, and they begin to make fun of the buildings and the neighborhoods. Now I understand their confusion, and you probably do too. For most of you, it doesn't warm your heart when you see the city of Kansas City. I mean, it's not where you grow up. It's not your home. But if you're a believer, I guarantee you that the sight of heaven will warm your heart, because this real place is described as a home for every Christian. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 and 8, "For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands." And then later in that passage, verse 8 says, "We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord." And as strange as that might seem, Even though you've never been there, it will feel like home because you were created in the image of God and He instilled that desire within you, that longing. For Christians, our home is where Christ is. Jesus goes on to say, I am going there to prepare a place for you, that you also may be where I am. Heaven will be a restoration project. You know, we love that concept. That's why we watch shows like Extreme Makeover Home Edition or Fixer Upper. Because we love to see the old become new and the obsolete give way to the functional. Acts chapter 3, verse 21 says that God will restore everything. Matthew 19:28 says that there will be a renewal, that there will be a restoration. Many scholars believe that heaven will be similar to the original Garden of Eden. The only difference is that the Lord has been working on preparing your place for more than 2,000 years. Remember that in the Garden of Eden, God said, "This is good." It wasn't bad until Satan came along and sin entered the picture. When God created Eden and He placed man in it, He personally planted it. He wanted it to be a paradise on earth. It would be a place where man would be fulfilled. It was a place where even God could dwell. It was the perfect place for man and for God to commune. But sin changed all that, and Eden became only a shadow of what it had once been. Revelation 21:1 says that there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And the word new here means new in quality. It's not as though it never existed. You know, I might say, come over and look at my new kitchen. Now, it's not really new. I mean, we had a kitchen before. It's just been restored. It's been made better than ever. 2 Peter chapter 3 talks about this earth being purged by fire, that God will build a new heaven and perhaps bring it to the new earth. And then another reason we know heaven to be a real physical place is that it will have an actual city. Numerous times in the New Testament, we have described this city, a city that will be known as the New Jerusalem. We see this in Hebrews chapters 11 and 12, and in Revelation chapter 13, and in Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 and 2. And then later in that 21st chapter, in the 23rd verse, it says, the city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. So this city is described in Revelation 21 as a 1,500-mile cube, meaning that it goes upwards too. And John writes that the dimensions are according to human measurements. So this certainly implies that this is not some figurative number, but that it could be taken literally. Those dimensions would cover some 2 million square miles. And so try and put the size of heaven, to try and put it somewhat in perspective, that would be a city that would stretch from Canada to Mexico and Kentucky to California. And it would be 780,000 stories high. And that's just the city. Just the fact that the dimensions are mentioned in such specific fashion underscores that heaven is an actual place with an actual city. Now, for those of you who prefer rural settings to metropolitan areas, don't worry, there's a place for you. That's why in Revelation it says that you can go in and out of the city, which means that there is all kinds of territory to explore. There are gates on each side for coming and going. And so realize this heaven is not some mystical area exempt of floors and ceiling and dominated simply by clouds. No, it is an actual place with streets lined with gold. But notice that heaven is also a transforming place. In the Chronicles of Narnia, the children live at home with Lord Diggory. And after their adventure, he puts things in perspective by telling the children, he says this, he says, our own world is only a shadow or a copy of something in Aslan's real world. Now, why would C.S. Lewis, the author of the Chronicles of Narnia, write that line to describe heaven? Well, it's because the Bible speaks that it's a place where transformation takes place. In John chapter 3, verse 2, Jesus says, dear friends, or excuse me, 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, John says, dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We will be transformed physically. Now, we'll be ourselves in heaven with a glorified body somehow. It's tough to know exactly what that means. You know, the older I get, the more changes I need to make. But we would all agree that this phenomena is one of the reasons we're excited about heaven. Instant transformation is pretty appealing. Heard the story of a country farmer who, along with his wife and son, ventured to the big city for the very first time. And they were amazed by everything they saw there. They parked in front of a huge building, and the wife stayed in the car while the farmer and the son went in to buy a big city newspaper. And while they were in the lobby, they were mesmerized by these two shiny silver walls that would move apart and then back together again. And the boy asked his father, hey, Paul, what is this? Well, the father, you know, never having seen an elevator, responded, son, I've never seen anything like this in my life. I don't know what it is. Well, while the boy and his father were watching wide-eyed, an elderly lady came limping along with a cane. She was kind of hunched over. She walked up to the moving walls. She pressed a button. The walls opened, and the feeble lady walked in and into this small room, and the walls closed by themselves, and the boy and his father watched these small circles of light with numbers above the doors began to flash intermittently. Well, they continued to watch the circles until the walls opened up again, and out walked this beautiful 24-year-old woman who smiled this beautiful smile and sauntered past them. And immediately the father said to his son, boy, go get your mama. Heaven will be instant transformation. The Bible says in a twinkling of an eye. I mean, that's much faster than an elevator. And when we get to heaven, our physical transformation will be similar to what Christ's body went through after his physical death and resurrection. There was some slight change in his appearance, and so a couple of times people had to do kind of a double take to make certain that it was he. And we can understand that in our culture, you know, living in this day and this time of plastic surgery and steroids and Botox and LASIK and liposuction. When there's been a subtle change in a person physically, from a distance, we may be uncertain of someone's identity, and we kind of do a double take at first. But when you see a mannerism, you know that it's the person you thought it might have been. And so rest assured, in heaven, in light of some form of physical transformation, your identity will still be known and evident. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20, "But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive." Our physical bodies are transformed. No more aging. Romans 8:23 says, "Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies." And so somehow our bodies will go through some type of redemption, a glorified improvement or enhancement. Philippians 3, verses 20 and 21 say, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly bodies so they will be like His glorious body." But realize there is something that is more important than your physical condition in this life, and that is your soul for eternity. Those who swallow their pride in this life and trust in Christ can look forward to another change. They will be transformed spiritually. In our resurrected state, we will have spiritual bodies with physical substance. Look with me at 1 Corinthians 15, verses 42 to 44. "So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable, it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body." In heaven, there will have been a spiritual transformation. No more inclination to rebel, no sin, so no temptation. And can you imagine life in that environment? You know, I hear people say, "You know, I don't mind if I go to hell. I'll just party with my friends forever." But if by rejecting Jesus Christ you end up in hell, don't throw any parties. Just save your money on the invitations, because part of what makes hell such a terrible place is that hell is a place of eternal separation. The person who is in hell will be all alone. There'll be no fellowship, no camaraderie, and all of that pales in comparison to the fact that for the very first time in their life, they will experience being separated from God. Randy Alcorn says that we have allowed Satan to dupe us into thinking that the temporary pleasures of sin could even be in the same league as the blessings and opportunities that God has planned for us. Sin robs us, he says, of fulfillment, and it makes us empty. While God promises in, while God promises in Psalm 16:11 that we will be filled with joy and eternal pleasure. Christian, don't trade what you've got for a cheap imitation of the real thing, Alcorn writes. There is no comparison. I mean, that's like comparing looking at a picture of an apple versus taking a bite out of the apple and enjoying it. It's like watching the Super Bowl on a tiny black and white television, or actually being at the Super Bowl in person and experiencing all of the excitement firsthand. Heaven will put earth to shame in every category. It's in a totally different hemisphere, literally. Paul goes on to say in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 and 52, "We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. You see, heaven is an actual place, and it's a transforming place. And contrary to popular opinion, it is also an exciting place. Please do not buy into the stereotype that heaven is going to be a boring place. I mean, how can it be boring if the one who created this earth, the one who made every animal and every mountain, the one who makes rainbows, the father of creativity, if he is there and he's been anticipating your arrival, how can it be boring? We're going to talk more about that later in this series, but know this, heaven is exhilarating, refreshing, and fulfilling. Heaven is going to be thrilling. Everything that is good here will be perfect there. Everything that is bad here will be absent there. It will be nothing like you could ever imagine. That's why Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2:9 that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love Him. Does that get you pumped up? You know, I love surprises, and God's Word said that you can't even begin to conceive what He has prepared for you in heaven. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 1, verse 23, I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Better by far, Paul says. To be with Christ is better by far. I love it when I have the chance to go to Costco or to a Sam's Club, sometimes right before lunchtime, you know, on a Saturday morning. You know why? Because they offer free snacks. Actually, they're free samples. But if you plan your route through all of the aisles strategically, you can eventually make it by all of the food stations. By strategically walking just a few right aisles, you can leave there having eaten almost a four-course meal. You know what I mean? No, don't laugh, because you do the very same thing. But when you go into an ice cream shop and ask for a sample of some flavor, they don't give you no two big dips of it, do they? No, they give you this tiny little pink spoon. Why is that? Well, they just want to whet your appetite for more. It's just a taste of what's to come. Every now and then, we get a glimpse or a moment that whets your appetite for what heaven will be like. God wants you to anticipate how awesome it will be. Maybe your divine free sample is your heart beating faster when you see a friend or a family member step into a baptistry and you feel a tear rolling down your face as she says the good confession. Well, that's what heaven will feel all the time. I know of a Christian couple who were waiting to adopt a baby, but when this baby was born with some severe health problems, the doctor advised them to wait for another one. You know, you don't want this child, he said. And the couple said, yes, we do. And the doctor said she would always be a slow learner. But now, when she consistently brings home straight A's on her report card, or when she sings a solo in the school choir, in those moments, I think her parents have been given a bite-sized dose of heaven. When you and a friend break into a belly laugh over something that happened years ago, and your sides begin to hurt, and your face hasn't smiled that big smile in months, that is a glimpse of heaven. When you hear a doctor say, I don't know how to tell you this, and medically it doesn't make any sense, but the tumor is gone, or the cancer has been completely removed, that is a spoonful of heaven. When you're standing at the Grand Canyon or Niagara Falls or in the sand by the ocean and the beauty and enormity takes your breath away, That's a foretaste of glory divine. When you watch a disabled boy compete in Special Olympics and cross that finish line, when your daughter plays in the recital and hits every note, when your granddad smiles and gives you a wink, and you know that you have pleased him, those are heavenly pink spoons when you've been exposed to just a tiny swallow of what heaven will be continuously. I guess what I'm asking is, would you like to go to a place that is better by far? I got to tell you, I can't wait to get there. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, "So we don't look at the troubles we can now see. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever." In the series of books, The Chronicles of Narnia, C.S. Lewis paints a beautiful picture of heaven in the final book, The Last Battle. The book begins with a near collision of a railroad train where the children are thrust into Narnia. And Narnia, as you know if you've read the books, represents heaven. But when their adventure is over, the children are afraid that they're going to be sent back to Earth. Having experienced the joys and the wonders of Narnia and the presence of Aslan, you know, the lion in the story who represents Jesus Christ, the thought of having to return to Earth was just unbearable for the children. But then Aslan gently shares with them some good news. C.S. Lewis writes, "Aslan says to the children, there was a real railway accident, and you did die. The dream is ended. This is the morning." And as Aslan spoke, he no longer looked to them like a lion, but the things that began to happen after that were so great and beautiful that I cannot write them. And for us, this is the end of all the stories, and we can most truly say that they all lived happily ever after. But for them, it was only the beginning of the real story. All their life in this world and all their adventures in Narnia had only been the cover and the title page. Now at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before. That is what heaven will be like. And I don't know if you'll have 69 more years or 69 more minutes to prepare for that, but I want you to be prepared. Regardless of that, today, look forward to heaven and prepare for the incredible journey so that you will get to experience in the presence and the company of the one who loved you so much that he died so that you might live forever at a home that he has prepared for you. Your heavenly travel agent has an incredible adventure for all eternity that he has been preparing for you. Do you have your ticket? The only people who will go are those who have humbly prepared and are trusting him with everything.
This song that we're about to sing, it is a prayer and it comes straight from Scripture. So if you believe in the power of prayer as we sing this song, when we celebrate baptisms, I want you to think about the people that are around you in this room and our community that's online. And let's pray this over each other. The Lord.
shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.